Hey, man, it's me, Kevin Smith, the annoying voice of podcasting. And you're listening to the non-annoying Three Guys in a Flick.
Ladies and gentlemen, please take your seats. The show is about to begin.
You're not perfect, sport. And let me save you the suspense. This girl you've met, she's not perfect either. But the question is whether or not you're perfect for each other.
Three guys and a flick with Don, Ken, and John. Dive into the movies well after the dawn. From the good to the bad to the wildly absurd. They give a fuck about films. Their voices are heard.
Welcome back. You are listening to Three Guys and a Flick. This is where we review the good, the bad, and the absurd. Tonight's episode, Good Will Hunting. Beware spoilers. Coming to you from a Harvard bar, my name is John, a.k.a. the comic book guy. And to my left, we have the professor, Ken.
Hello, everybody.
And to my right, rejoining us as a special guest, Katie.
Hi.
Welcome back, Katie.
Thank you.
As you might detect, Dawn, our regular host, is once again absent. I believe they are not letting him back in the country, so we'll have to see if he makes it across the border for next week's show. That or he heard Katie was going to be here, and hey. So he's boycotting the show. Well, he did say that the last time you were on the show, that's the most editing he's ever had to do on a show.
Oh, no. Why? Because of me? Or just was it happened
I don't know,
that way?
Tapping the microphone, tapping the table, just because you wanted to see if we heard it.
Oh, no. And I was pressing all the buttons, too. I was insufferable.
So, Katie, you picked this movie, Good Will Hunting. Why Good Will Hunting?
I picked this movie because I love Robin Williams. There's a lot to talk about in the story, in the character arc, in the people who made it, how it was made. I figured we would have a lot to talk about. That's why I picked it. And you hadn't done it yet.
Well, I have a feeling we're going to be doing a lot of talking about this one. Good Will Hunting was released on December 5th, 1997, directed by Gus Van Sant, written by Ben Affleck and Matt Damon, and it stars Robin Williams, Matt Damon, Ben Affleck, Stellan Skarsgård, Minnie Driver, and a bunch of other emotionally challenged folks.
How'd this movie do, John?
This movie was made for $10 million, and it brought in $226 million.
So the year it came out, though, it only generated $7 million.
Really?
Yes.
Why so low?
Because it was December, and so it only had a month. It made its lion's share the following year because it was popular. And so in 1998, it made $130 million. I was looking at the box office and, you know, John, I've talked about this before and it's a curious thing. And we never really came up with a pertinent reason why some theaters choose to do this. The first week that it was released in theaters, seven theaters in its first week.
Wow.
Yeah, and it landed at number 19 that week. In the second week, it was 10 theaters. Third week, 11. Fourth week, 157. Why do they do this? It's so odd. It was finally in the sixth week, it was released to 1,700 theaters. And at that time, it made it to the number two spot. And it stayed in the top 10 for 18 weeks. Anyway, it's curious why they do such a small release like that at first.
Well, I do know that when it came time to push this movie out, they just pushed Robin Williams. They just said, we've got Robin Williams in a movie, go see it for Robin Williams. As because Matt Damon and Ben Affleck weren't very well known. And Minnie Driver, I think this was her second ever movie. So he was basically the build label or build star of this movie.
Well, he definitely opened up the sluice gates. Ben and Matt both have commented that it was very, very difficult to get this project off the ground. And it was an arduous journey and they didn't know if it was ever going to happen. Despite the fact that they did have Kevin Smith in the wheelhouse, that still didn't necessarily, make anything really break free. The sluice gates really opened up once they had Robin Williams on board. And then from there, things really took off. And then it became a serious production. And then off we went. And Harvey Weinstein, goddamn him. Mm-hmm. And, from there, it became Good Will Hunting.
Yeah. From what I have read, tons of studios turned it down. And then it got picked up by Castle Rock. They wanted Brad Pitt and Leonardo DiCaprio to be the two stars of the movie.
As good of a cat, like a duo that is, I feel like Leo could not have pulled off the role of Will if that was what the assignment was going to be, which I'm assuming it would have been.
Well, they were going to completely change what this movie was, so I don't even know how it would have been with them. Ben Affleck and Matt Damon insisted they wanted to star in the movie. Then they went for the longest time trying to figure out how to get it, and Kevin Smith, they talked to him, and he went to Harvey Weinstein and says, you got to get this movie. Castle Rock said, we will sell this movie if you can find somebody who will pay all that we put into this movie. And after Kevin Smith approached Harvey Weinstein, he agreed to put in the money and to let Ben Affleck and Matt Damon star in the movie. So he pretty much gave them a green light to make this movie. And then it would help them to get Robin Williams. And I thought it was funny, when they first gave the script to Robin Williams, he said, love it, but who the hell are these guys?
Yeah.
Because he had never heard of them. But he was in right away. He loved the movie. They even went to Kevin Smith originally and said, Ben Affleck and Ben and Matt basically went to him and said, we want you to direct this movie. Because they had already done, you know, several movies with him. You know, Chasing Amy being one of the big ones.
Right.
And
Dogma.
Dogma, all that. And so they went to him and he said, I'm not good enough to make this movie. This is an amazing movie. I'm not good enough. I know you're also looking at Gus Van Sant. You need to go with him. He can make this movie. But Kevin Smith still went ahead and executive produced this movie.
So who's Kevin Smith?
Shame on you.
So Kevin Smith has written and directed a lot of his own projects that have a very strong cult following.
What has he made that I would know?
For a movie, if you want to start on Kevin Smith and really get to know him, I recommend you watch the movie Tusk.
Okay. No.
What's Tusk?
What's wrong with Tusk?
No.
I already hate it, but what is it?
Tusk is a movie where a guy gets kidnapped by this person out in the woods, and slowly the guy performs a bunch of surgeries on him to turn him into a walrus.
No.
It's a fantastic movie. We should be reviewing that movie. That movie needs to be in the helmet.
It's just giving a very similar vibe to Human Centipede.
Seriously, though, I would either start with Dogma.
Okay.
But Dogma introduces some characters that are from, or not introduces, but brings back some characters from his past movies. Well, Jay and Silent Bob. So you may not understand who they are. If you want to understand who they are, watch Clerks.
That's what I was going to say.
Yeah.
If you want,
what genre is that? Comedy?
Yes.
We reviewed it. You should go check it out.
Noted.
The director of this movie, Gus Van Sant. Are you familiar with him at all?
No, not really. I mean, I've seen To Die For. I saw Finding Forrester back in VHS. But, you know, this is a guy that's largely known for music videos. He's got a lot of music videos that he's done.
It's interesting that he's directing this then.
The only one that I knew him from was My Private Idaho. That's the only one that I'd seen with River Phoenix. I'd only seen that movie. And I saw that back in college and don't remember it very much, but they were insistent. They wanted him to direct this movie.
Curious. Well, you know, it pays off because, you know, look what it did for the Oscars. You know, it got nominated for picture, actor, actress, director, editing, music for the original song and for the musical score. And it won two Oscars, one for supporting for Robin Williams and then one for writing Ben and Matt.
The best thing about this, or I don't know if it's sad too, but it's the only Oscar Robin Williams ever won. Was for best supporting actress for this movie. He was nominated for, I think, four or five.
This is the only time he ever won.
This is the only time he won an Oscar. He won Emmys and other things.
That's absurd.
I know.
That's absurd.
You think he would have gotten it for Dead Poets Society or for some of the other movies he was in. But when I read that fact, that blew me away.
That's absurd. Robin Williams is one of my favorite people of all time. That's really sad.
This is the first time writing for Ben Affleck and Matt Damon. It was actually Matt Damon that wrote the movie. He was assigned to write just this small movie idea for one of his film classes and ended up bringing in a whole script for a movie. And that's the movie that they tried to push through. But it was actually supposed to be originally Good Will Hunting was written as a thriller. I did not know that. The whole plot of the movie was supposed to be, again, you have this character, Will Hunting, who's a super genius, can, you know, photographic memory, everything, can understand mathematics, except he was going to be chased by the government who want to use his services and force him to work for them. So though they kind of put that aside to make it more, and this was more of Harvey Weinstein and Kevin Smith and them kind of pushing this, they wanted to make it more focused on Will Hunting and Sean, you know, Robin Williams. They want to make it more about their sessions and more about the psychological aspect of someone who's been abused.
Right. I remember hearing back in the day that Matt and Ben, they were talking about, they had these scenes that they had put together, and the scenes they thought were strong, but they didn't have any cohesiveness to them. They didn't have any way to connect them together. And so that was part of their journey. And it's not unusual for when you have a script that goes to Hollywood that it encounters rewrites, lots of rewrites, lots and lots of rewrites. And it turns out that we only end up having one scene that stayed intact that they had put in. And it was the scene where Sean and Will first meet each other.
Yeah, their first session where Sean gets choked, that was the scene that was actually written in the original script. It's something I was going to mention was when Matt Damon wrote this movie, the reason why Ben Affleck is on there as a writer is because when it came time to turn it into a screenplay, that's when Ben Affleck came in and helped him make it a screenplay. So that's why they both get the writing credit. Did you read or did you hear what they put in the script to test all the producers and people interested in buying their script? They wanted to test that they actually read the script. So they added one scene in there that never was supposed to be made into the movie. Did you hear about what scene that was?
It's a hoot.
Basically, they wrote a scene in there.
It was an oral sex scene.
Yeah, where Will would give oral sex to the math professor.
What?
Yeah, and they just wrote that in because they wanted to see if anybody questioned on it. None of the people, original people, who basically said, we'll consider your script, or we, like even Castle Rock, nobody ever mentioned that. When it went to Harvey Weinstein, he said, love the script, we got to remove the oral sex part. Mm-hmm. What's that about? And they basically revealed, they just put that in there to test if people were reading their script.
That's so interesting.
It was actually Sean and Jerry, not Will.
But still, they put that in there.
That's crazy.
And it's funny that they would do that.
Yeah.
So besides Robin Williams, let's look at the rest of this cast. What did you guys think of Matt Damon as Will Hunting?
I think he's perfect. He's a hint of irritating, which I think his character has to be. Like, he's supposed to be kind of a dick.
I immediately got the fact that this is a closed off guy.
Yes.
Who's obviously had something happen to him in his life. And he comes off as a dick at times.
Yes.
But it's because he's emotionally walled up. And I thought Matt Damon did a great job of portraying that. What do you think of Matt Damon?
I loved him in this. The fact that he has this aloofness to him that, he's completely, boxed up and letting nobody in is wonderfully portrayed in this movie.
Yeah, and he's trying to seem so nonchalant, but you can tell he's very woundly tight, or tightly wound, but perfect actor for this role.
I agree. Ben Affleck, what do you guys think of Ben?
Ben was good. I think Ben played the perfect best friend supporter. Just in the body language, going to pick him up, the car, everything. And I love that one line where they go into that bar and he's like, why didn't you give me none of that nasty little stuff you usually give me? So funny. Mm-hmm. And he says it so, like, it feels like everything he's saying was not written. It was like how he would actually talk.
Ken, what do you think of Ben Affleck?
He was delightful in this. And it's probably my favorite role that I see him in. There's not too many other places that I really enjoy having him. And this is probably my favorite role for him.
I'm a little bit opposite on that.
You didn't like him in this?
Well, I thought he was okay, but we've talked about this before in some of our other podcasts. Was he Chucky? I mean, is he the perfect Chucky, or could anybody have played that role? And I feel like there's only one scene in this movie that Ben Affleck really shines. Otherwise, almost anybody else could have played that role. Now, the friendship between Matt and Ben, you can clearly see that they are friends. I mean, that really works. Otherwise, he didn't really do much for me, except for the scene when he went to pick Will up and Will didn't come to the door. That scene where he doesn't talk and he just shows his emotions, thought he really shined there. But otherwise in the movie, I didn't feel there was much shine to him. Minnie Driver. What'd you guys think?
I didn't know her from anywhere. And this is probably one of the few roles. The only other place that I really know her from is Gross Point Blank.
What else is she in nowadays?
She is in something very important nowadays.
She's in a TV show.
She does the voice for the Penguin in the new Batman animated series, Batman Caped Crusader on Prime. So, of course, she's now in the Batman lore. She's very important. When they first cast her, Harvey Weinstein said she wasn't pretty enough. They wanted to cast someone else. And Matt and Ben, they really fought to keep her in this movie. And I agree with their pick because she just needed to be that average college student, you know, someone from England who isn't super gorgeous, but can play the role.
Mm-hmm. Well, she got nominated for actress.
Yeah, and I thought she did a fantastic job. Especially when it got emotional near the end, I felt it from her.
I think she did a good job playing her role, and she's so delightful. Her personality in this film is so...
Yeah, she stands up to Will wonderfully.
She's the type of person in the movie where you watch it and you're like, I want to be her friend. Mm. She's fun.
And you can see them as a couple.
Yeah, it's believable. Yeah. And I also kind of like that she's not this drop-dead, gorgeous, unattainable. She's kind of like Girl Next Door, yeah. But not really. Girl Next Door is the wrong label for her, but college student.
Yeah.
So when it comes to Matt Damon movies, you got a Matt Damon movie that you think of? Or what do you like or love Matt Damon in?
Well, first of all, of course, being, you know, totally addicted to Kevin Smith movies, I got to go with Dogma. I really liked him in Dogma as Loki. When it comes down to what I think his best role ever was, I got to go with Good Will Hunting.
Yeah, he's super strong in this. I really dig him in the Oceans movies as well.
Oh, so good.
Yeah, yeah. And, you know, he was strong in the Martian.
Yeah, that is a good point. I didn't think about The Martian. That is a fun one, too, that he's in.
What about Ben Affleck movies? I have a significantly shorter list for him.
It's Daredevil on that?
No.
Is it Gone Girl?
Yeah, there's Gone Girl, Argo, The Town, and, you know, the Kevin Smith stuff, of course. Justice League, okay. Yeah, he's Batman, okay.
He is not my favorite Batman.
No.
He did an okay job, and he started to grow on me a little bit. I definitely like him much better than the current Batman, but he's not my favorite Batman.
And, you know, just to keep Don from stopping you yelling at us right now. Yes, Armageddon. He's in Armageddon too.
You know, that's a good point. I did like him. I was saying, I'm not usually a big fan of him. I did like him in Armageddon. Stellan Skarsgård. Do you guys know him from anywhere?
The only other place is Avengers.
From Thor. He was originally in the Thor movie.
And the Avengers, you know, with Loki. Yeah. Yeah. So, you know, that's it.
Yeah. Dune.
Oh, yeah, Dune.
The most horrifying character in Dune.
Do you know his son? He has like 8 children, I think.
Oh.
But one of them is named Bill.
Bill Skarsgård?
And I love Bill Skarsgård.
What is he in? Who is Bill?
He is from It. He is Pennywise in It.
Oh, that's horrifying. And Stellan did the perfect job of just playing, walking the line of being, I don't know about this guy. You're kind of watching the film thinking, who is he? And he's kind of...
He's a guy that you have a love-hate relationship with.
Well, I felt just only the hate side, and then it turned into, like, rage by the end. Well, he was always awful.
Well, for me...
And just the women swooning over him, I'm like, why? He's horrible. Why? Who would ever want to... Oh, God, it just made me want to gag.
I tried to kind of get in the minds of the different characters, you know, this round of watching this movie. I just like you, I've seen it many, many times. And I kind of saw where he was coming from. He kind of felt that he had wasted some of his potential. And he comes along and he finds this math genius that can be his way to almost revitalize his life through Will Hunting, in that Jerry doesn't want Will to waste his life. He wants him to go on to do these amazing, great things. And Jerry just loves mathematics and loves what he can produce. So his whole goal is to make something of Will, whereas Sean just wants Will to make his own decision. So it's these polar opposites of people pulling on him. And so I kind of understood where Sean was coming from, but I felt like he was just, everything was very selfish for him. He wasn't really focused on what, you know, Will wanted.
What was best for Will.
It was almost like two fathers fighting over for the future of their kid. Mm-hmm. Casey Affleck.
Love.
You loved Casey Affleck.
Love. Every scene he was in, love. My favorite character. So funny. So cute.
Oh, brother.
So scrumptious.
Scrumptious. Ken, any thoughts on Casey?
No, he's... I am unimpressed with him.
Love.
I don't know how I felt the first few times I saw this movie, but he annoyed the fuck out of me.
He's
this
supposed
movie.
To. He's my favorite character.
I didn't know into this until recently. He ad-libbed most of
Give
his lines.
Give him a fucking sandwich.
Yeah.
Just love him.
Did you use my baseball mitt? Yeah, it's soft. Why do you always do that in my mom's bedroom?
Oh my God.
She's got a VCR.
Just the best.
Pretty much the rest of the cast. Again, like I said earlier, you kind of take or leave them. There's nobody that really stands out. That fourth friend or whatever.
Oh, yeah.
Billy.
Billy, he has like, what, two or three lines even in the movie?
He doesn't talk.
Yeah, so he's
that much.
Not much, you know, in that.
Good physical presence.
Yeah. Let's talk for a second about the music in this. This was the first time I realized Danny Elfman did the music for this.
Indeed, he did.
Positive or negative feelings?
Good. Oh, I thought it was really good. In fact, I really tried. Normally, it's Ken and Don that really focus on the movie and the soundtracks and the needle drops and things like that. I tried to listen more in this movie, and I thought a lot of it really worked for this movie.
Yeah, I've certainly appreciated when we had Danny Elfman's musical score in the movie as opposed to all of that gentle guitar singing, you know, gushy music trying to make you feel sappy inside. It's like, man, the 90s. So glad we're away from this.
I would say the soundtrack behind the wardrobe in this film was my least favorite thing. I hated the music.
Yeah, all the guitar playing, singing stuff?
No, just all the music for the whole film.
Oh, even the strings?
And... I hated it. It
really?
It felt like they were trying to make it different. Like, oh, we're making a statement. It's different sounding, not like the regular films. And it felt like happy scenes were having sad music and then sad scenes were having happy music. And it was like, I think they're trying to make me feel multiple things. There's multiple layers here. You know, these two characters are happy, but they're sad inside. And I just didn't like it.
Maybe it was supposed to represent the conflict and the chaos going along inside of Matt's head.
It did, but I
just...
In
Will's head, so that he's going through an emotional battle, so you get an emotional battle.
I also just hate whenever soundtracks have that, like, that choir, but it sounds like they're in another room.
I can tell you, you're wrong about the last song, the needle drop in the movie, because in the middle part, I love when Matt Damon is supposedly hypnotized... And he starts to sing
Skyrockets in Flight.
Afternoon Delight. And then, of course, what do they end the movie with? Afternoon Delight. And that to me, well, for my age group, even though it's a little bit before me, that's just a fun song. Do you know what that song's about?
No, I've never heard that song except for in this movie.
Do you know what Afternoon Delight refers to?
Yes.
What is Afternoon Delight?
Sex. Dirty, dirty.
That's what Afternoon Delight is.
Naughty.
It's naughty, not dirty.
Naughty.
Say, John, is it about that time?
Why, yes. It is some time for some Harvard trivia. Are you ready?
I guess. I've never been to Harvard, so...
We know someone who's at Harvard.
We do.
She's really smart.
Is she wickedly smart?
Wicked smart.
So this is where Don would say a lot of spiel about being some kind of, you know, trivia overlord champion... I'm going to skip all that and say I'm going to read a series of questions, and please wait till I finish the questions before you answer, so that way you can become this week's trivia champion. Early on in the movie, Chucky asks Kathy why she didn't give him none of that nasty little hoochie-woochie last night. She says it's because of his Irish curse. She's not wasting her time spreading her legs for what?
Oh, excuse me.
And you have to use the term she uses.
I have no idea.
Oh, Tootsie Roll.
Very good. Point to Katie, that Tootsie Roll dick. Don't you love the way I talk in front of your daughter? Question number two. When Skylar suggests her and Will meet for coffee, what does Will say is just as arbitrary as drinking coffee?
Caramels.
Goes to Ken, eating a bunch of caramels.
Oh, I didn't know this was a timed test.
It's not a timed test.
Okay, but I could have gotten it faster than you.
Okay.
Okay.
Well, game on.
People are going to think we hate each other, but I love you.
Third question. According to Sean, while teaching his class, when do you want to nail them?
I have no idea.
I don't know.
When they are vulnerable.
Oh, I knew that.
After Skylar and Will's first kiss at dinner, what does Skylar comment that she got?
Some of his pickle.
Some of his pickle in her mouth. Yeah, yes.
She goes, oh, you were hoping for a first night kiss. And he goes, I was hoping to get first night laid or first date laid.
Yeah, but I'll settle for a kiss.
That's hilarious.
At the job interview, Will sends Chucky in his place as his negotiator. What is the name of the company?
I'd have to look.
I don't know, but what a great time.
The company's name is Holden and McNeil. Bonus question. What other movie is the name Holden McNeil a callback to?
I forget. I read it and I forget.
Is it a movie I've seen?
Nope.
Okay, then I'm not going to know.
Holden McNeil was a character that Kevin Smith created for the movie Chasing Amy. Then that character resurfaced again in Jay and Silent Bob Strike Back and Jay and Silent Bob Reboot. So that was a call out to Kevin Smith to use that name, Holden McNeil. Little Easter egg.
Pretty obscure.
I love Easter eggs.
So I believe, Ken, you have won this week. Congratulations. You are one step closer to trivia immortality.
Nice.
That was five questions?
Yeah, well, if you count the bonus question. Then call out Don for that.
Then it's not a bonus question.
Well, it was an add-on.
Okay, but that would be five questions then.
Okay, well, that's five questions.
There you go.
Did I ask five questions? I asked five questions. I'm about to take away a point and give it to your daughter.
You can do that too.
Congratulations, Katie.
Yeah.
You are one step closer to trivia immortality.
I love winning.
Twenty-year-old Will Hunting of South Boston is a self-taught math genius who was recently paroled after completing a prison term. He works as a janitor at MIT and spends his free time drinking with his friends Chucky, Billy, and Morgan. When Professor Gerard Lambeau posts a difficult mathematical problem on a blackboard as a challenge for his graduate students, Will solves the problem anonymously, stunning both the students and Lambeau. As a challenge to the unknown genius, Lambeau posts an even more difficult problem. He later catches Will writing the solution on the blackboard late at night, but initially thinks Will is vandalizing it and chases him off. At the bar, Will meets Skylar, an English woman about to graduate from Harvard College, who plans on attending medical school at Stanford.
So the movie opens and Will is sitting there reading the way that he reads. Flip, 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 flip. And Chucky comes and picks him up. And this is one of several times that we see Chucky pulling up to pick up Will for work.
Mm-hmm. We kind of start to get their routine.
Right. Cut to Lambo, and he's busy lecturing his class. Right off the bat, he comes across as this pompous little arrogant prick because of his scarf.
Oh my God, the skinny scarf. The skinny scarf with stripes was killing me the entire movie, and he would wear it with striped shirts that were going the other way and then a plaid over shirt. I hated the scarf. I hated it. Oh my God, I hated it, and it made me hate him even more.
So I'm getting the feeling you didn't like it.
So you could tell everything you needed to know from this character by how he dressed.
Yes.
Well, and the flamboyant nature of his dialogue, and he just comes across as smug.
Well, I got that from him kind of, he put his credentials out there right away. He mentions that this problem that he has, you know, up on this blackboard, you know, only these super smart people have ever solved it, and he just happens to be one of them.
So, yeah, so he says that he has this problem put out on the board in the hallway, and he's hoping that someone might be able to prove it by the end of the semester. So this is telling us this is supposed to be something incredibly sophisticated. And then we cut to Will, and he's pushing a mop bucket, and he happens to spot the chalkboard. Then we cut to Will and Chucky, and they are at their local watering hole. And, you know, this is where we get to see the gang, you know, in their full revelry towards each other and the crassness. And I forgot to look. I wanted to look. How many F-bombs were in this movie?
Oh, that had to be a ton.
Yes.
The word wicked and fuck was probably said more than anything else in this movie.
Probably.
Yeah.
Which tells me it's Boston. I mean, that you just got to do that, and then you have a movie from Boston.
You know, and then after the Tootsie Roll comment, we have Chucky kind of trying to, you know, make himself feel a little better when he's, I love the line that he says, you know, well, there's only so many times you can bang your friend's future wife. Yeah.
He also even says, well, she's missing a tooth.
Yeah, it's good.
So Will decides he's taken off early. What? It's too early. Next shot, we have Will, and he's back at school, and he's buffing the floor where the chalkboard with the math problem is. And what does he do? He goes ahead, and he picks up that piece of chalk, and he starts writing.
Mm-hmm. He solved it pretty quick.
We cut to Chucky, and he's at the batting cages. And they're talking, and it's like, hey, let's go up to Harvard next weekend.
These guys have nothing better to do with their time than hang out at a batting cage, like, of all the places that they could hang out. Like, and then this theme continues throughout the whole movie where they're just like twiddling their thumbs, essentially.
Yeah. All they really do is screw around and drink.
Yes.
And that's their whole
thing.
And
get into fights.
But that kind of makes sense because they work all day, and what else is there for them to do?
I know. It's just funny.
The gang, they are at a baseball game.
Oh, that wasn't then, was it?
They are at a baseball game.
So good.
And they're looking at some asshole down in the front, and it's a guy from Will's kindergarten.
That's right. We get the revealing that he used to be a bully.
Yeah, and so, you know, who's the hottie? And then so they start talking about that guy, right?
And then they're And then
after the game, it's like, oh, they spot him, and
they're just driving around looking for trouble, and you have that whole exchange with Sandwich.
Well, I don't think that they're necessarily looking for trouble, but
like they're so open to it because the first thing that Chucky says is, what do we got here? And then if you don't get out there and whip his ass or whatever he said, like, I'm coming after you next, like, as if they do this sort of thing all the time.
But
the tone it gave.
But it's not just them jumping out of the car to beat someone up.
No, but it's someone of significance.
They watch this guy with his friends talk really shitty to a couple of girls.
Yes.
And that's what prompts them to go teach them a lesson.
Exactly.
And
which is good.
Fuels the fire of, you know, Matt Damon's Will Hunting. He has a lot of inner demons, and this is where we really get to see he's not all right in the head. When they get in a fight and he just keeps punching the guy, even with the police coming,
just
and the police almost
and
there,
and he's down.
He is still beating on the guy. And so this is our first indication. You know, we know that he's wickedly smart, just out on parole, things like that. This is our indication of he's got some mental issues.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's got some baggage.
And I love the car ride, though, right before with the sandwiches.
Yes.
It's one of my favorite scenes in the whole movie.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he's going to put the burger on layaway.
Yeah, the 6 cents every day. And they're arguing back and forth.
The other little bit we get with the fight is as the police are breaking it up, Will clocks one of the police officers.
Oh, it's like, why?
Exactly. This is a guy that has some pent up issues. Then we get to Lambo, and all right, who solved the problem?
Oh yeah, who solved the problem? Well, nobody comes forward, so he says, okay, well, I'm going to put up a second problem that took us
more than 2 years.
Than 2 years to solve it. And, you know.
Well, for somebody to as rapidly solve the previous problem that was supposed to take a semester, I'm sure it.
He just wanted to ramp it up.
They were hoping that it was going to entice this mystery person to, you know, to come forward.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I think.
Yeah.
So the next scene we got Will, he's coming out of the police station. So when's the arraignment? Next week. It's like, oh, wow, they do this all the time, apparently.
Well, and I love how he's just there to pick him up and there's no judgment.
So now he's back at the chalkboard, but he ends up being discovered by Tom. What'd you think of Lambo's assistant, Tom?
He eventually, you know, when in the beginning, he's exactly what I remember from all of my college classes for any TA kind of, you know, professor's assistant, anything like that. They're always kind of quiet. They're always kissing up to the teachers or the professor, almost like they idolize them.
Yeah.
And of course, you know, he had at that point had a lot of pride in himself that he was, you know, the number two guy.
Right.
And that obviously, it was kind of fun to watch that attitude change through the movie.
He's no longer the favorite son as the movie goes on.
Right.
But, you know, here we have the professor's reaction to him of chasing him off because he thinks he's doing graffiti on the board.
So when Lambo comes back to the board, Lambo looks at it. And he's like, oh, my God. And then Tom says, looks right.
And so, of course, Will has basically run out and has abandoned this job. This is kind of our first start of the idea that he will abandon things before they abandon him.
Right.
So instead of waiting to be fired, he's just not going to go back to work.
Yeah. And this is revealed to us, the audience, in the next scene, because the gang is together and Will says that he got fired. And so now they are up at that bar up in Harvard.
I love how Chucky, when they walk in, thought, I thought there'd be math equations over all the walls.
This is
a Harvard bar.
So good.
And immediately, Chucky spots two girls at the end of the bar.
Oh, what a delightful walk he has over
and
there.
And he's like, you know, he's all setting himself up to strutting towards the two
so
girls.
It's so good.
I'm going to have to bust a move on them Harvard hotties down there at the bar.
And then you just see Will, you know, kind of creeping, ready to swoop in. And then you see Chucky come up.
Yeah, so Morgan's there on the other side.
I just love their friend group. Like, they support each other and talk shit.
Well, Katie, you go to a lot of bars.
Don't say that on this podcast, please.
What's the best pickup line anybody's ever used on you?
I feel like no one uses pickup lines anymore. One pickup line that was really funny was, are you a campfire? Because it's hot in here, or something like you're saying you're hot. I was not a fan.
So back to Chucky. He approaches the girl. Hey, I think I had a class with you.
Oh, it's so bad. And it's so bad.
I think it's pretty obvious right away
she knows
he's not being truthful, but it's cute. And
she's
it's
not
fun.
Mad about it.
And they're having fun with him.
She's not mad about it at all.
And then we get the dick.
The arrogant, snooty Clark.
First of all, let's just talk about how ugly.
Him and his long blonde hair.
Oh, it's horrible. It's horrible.
I thought you would just hate the fact that he was wearing like a shirt, like with the sleeves coming down over his front.
Oh, I hated that too.
Guys that do
and
that.
I love when Minnie Driver goes, will you just go away? And I'm like, oh, I wish I could say that to somebody.
The contempt in her voice.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
You know,
and the fact that he's still trying even after he's been openly rejected by her.
The impression that I got is that he had been previously hitting on them as well, because he seemed like he was either coming back from the bathroom or something. And he, you know, said, well, I'm just talking with my friends. So like he had been flirting with them before that and they were having none of it.
Right.
So bad.
And so this is where we get the reveal of just how brilliant Will is when he comes in to rescue Chucky from Clark.
Mm-hmm. And just shuts him down.
Oh my gosh, he completely destroys him.
And my favorite part is not so much when he starts spouting off on everything. When Clark tries to respond with something, he calls him out for, you're repeating that line from the book. Do you even have an original thought?
Yes.
And then the guy's like, well, eventually I'll have a Harvard degree.
I loved
Will's response.
He said, at least I won't be unoriginal.
And then it closes up with, my boy's wicked smart.
Yeah, I love that. See, this is why Casey's the best character. Mm-hmm. I ate a bug. I swallowed a bug.
One of the things...
He's so good.
One of the things I've always said about women actors in movies is I've always liked women characters that are strong and don't just sit back to be rescued, that they can kind of make the first moves in there. So I love the fact that Minnie Driver came up and informed him that he was an idiot because she's been staring at him and waiting for him to come and talk to her the whole night. And she makes the first move of, here's my number, call me for coffee.
I would say 80% of the time that's what happens. Yeah. The girl hits on the boy.
Yeah, and I just love that fact because guys don't know what the hell they're doing.
No.
So
no one knows.
So that right there made me find her adorable.
She's great.
She's delightful.
Yeah, absolutely. Then I think, don't we get Will in court?
Well,
before that, there's the most important scene, which is Will leaving the bar after getting the phone number.
And he spots Clark in the little froyo place. And
he's got a little crowd in there, too.
Yeah. And so he goes up and he bangs on the window and he says that infamous line, which
very famous,
probably the most quoted line of the movie.
Probably
I'd
one
say.
Of the most top 10 quoted movie lines of all time.
Yeah. So, yeah, he bangs on the window. Do you like apples? Yeah. Well, I got a number. How do you like them apples?
It's so good.
The same line was used by private detective J.J. Jitters in Chinatown, a 1974 movie. So I didn't know that line actually came from another movie.
I didn't know that either. It's what we call a fun fact.
Mm-hmm. And so the night wraps up at dawn. Will's being fucking dropped off at dawn. Oh. Lambo, he goes down to the maintenance shed or wherever that is, and he's asking about, you know, who is this guy? And so he finds out that he has a parole officer, and this is where we see his name, Will Hunting, on that little parole officer mm-hmm. card. So next scene, Lambo, he's sitting in Will's court hearing, and then we get to hear Will just being, you know, obnoxiously smart. But then the judge comes right back with, you know, his rap sheet.
Yeah.
And so we, the audience, get to learn that, you know, Will has a very sordid and dark history.
Well, he basically, almost all of the charges, obviously, except for the one, whatever he went to jail for, which I don't think they ever mention, he's talked his way out of.
Right.
And it's because he's just read a lot of law books.
Right.
And he can just recite them. But all these different things like stealing a car and other stuff, he's come up with something to get him off. And this one, the judge is like, no, you're not getting off.
You're
this
going
time.
In. Your motion is denied. $50,000 bail.
You hit a cop. You're going in.
Yeah.
And they did slip in that he was taken out of a foster home because of abuse. And I didn't know if that was a hint of him being abusive or he was abused. Yeah. And I'm like, maybe this is a little nugget into his psyche.
I got the quick impression that it was him being abused and probably guessing that he had been bouncing around.
Yeah.
But the interesting thing to me was when he said, you're going in, Will's reaction to that was nonchalant. He was like, okay, whatever. Like he
was not pressed.
He just did not seem to care. And then we get that phone call.
Right.
Which he decides to finally call the, you know, Skyler, who, interesting note, when writing this movie, do you know where he got the movie, the name Skyler?
I hadn't heard until we did we got this movie and I read about it.
Yeah, Skyler was the name of his girlfriend in college who broke his heart.
So cute.
So when he was writing this and all that, she broke up with him or cheated on him or something, but he still ended up using Skyler in the script.
Yeah, I guess she ended up going to one of the band members from Metallica.
Metallica, yeah, exactly. She cheated nice. With a guy from Metallica.
I love how he calls her and he says, you know that...
No, I love when she answers. Do you remember what she said?
That's what I'm getting at.
Yeah.
I
let the guy talk.
Sorry.
I love how, you know, he calls, you know, that really funny, good-looking guy you met at the bar the other night?
And she's then, like, no.
And then the way she comes back immediately, I don't recall meeting anyone who matches that description. I think I'd remember.
Mm-hmm. And then what does he say after that?
Well, what I just love is that, you know, she goes toe-to-toe with him each time.
Yeah, he's like, well, do you remember that really idiotic, ugly guy or something like that? And she's like, oh, hey, Will.
Mm-hmm.
And then what I love how that call ended when, you know, of course, you got someone walking to the prison Will
recognize each other from juvie.
You can hear them talking. And then he turns around and says, you wouldn't happen to be pre-law, would you?
That was just so good.
And the fact that he's willing to make plans with her when, how in the world could you be making plans given your current predicament?
Yeah, because he's like, well, we'll just meet next week for coffee or whatever. And he's going to be in jail.
I love it. I also love that in every scene, she picks up the phone on the first ring.
Well, she's waiting for him.
But I just love that she's just unapologetic. What? You know? Yeah. Versus most people, I feel like nowadays are kind of playing a game, right? If someone calls, you're not going to answer. If they text, you're going to wait to respond. But she's just done with that.
My philosophy in college was if a girl let the phone ring twice, I was done. I walk away.
Why?
I'm kidding.
Oh.
Like girls like would talk to me in college. Come on.
That's true. Wait, did I say that out loud?
Dad.
I mean, I was thinking something, but did I
say that? No, he knows.
So Lambo introduces himself to Will, and it turns out that he is released under his supervision on two conditions. You meet with me every week, and you need to see a therapist. And if you fail to meet any of those conditions, then you'll have to serve time.
And Will's first reaction is, I'll meet with you, but I'm not doing the therapist thing. So right away, you can see he does not...
Not at all.
Not a fan of therapy, not a fan of talking to people.
So now we see Jerry and Will spending time together doing math, you know, where they're Jerry's definitely having fun with this.
It's really weird to me when he puts his arm around him or tussles his hair or something. I'm just like, this is weird.
Again, this is the whole thing of, I feel like he was becoming a father figure, that this is my boy and all this stuff. And you know, and I just love in the background, the TA.
Tom. Yes.
Yes.
Tom's reactions of.
He is hurt.
Just. Shattered. He's almost got tears in his eyes that he is not the favorite anymore.
We get that whole thing. And then we also get kind of a series of Will going and seeing different therapists.
Right. We get to meet a couple of his therapists. The first one, you know, well, I read your book and Mike was having some problems.
I love the
that
scene
Chad,
before
the stockbroker, was having Will.
And he's just flip, throw it down. And then exactly what you just said. And this guy is so old and so slow and so just
I don't remember his name, but he was actually a famous guy in the real world who is, I think, wrote a lot of books.
George Plimpton.
Yeah, I think he wrote some
George
books.
George Plimpton.
He wasn't an actor. He was a guy, I think, that wrote books, things like that. But I love how you can kind of see how, did you get how Will was probing him?
Yes.
Trying to find that one point, that one thing he could just stab him with to set him off. And he tried all these different things, and then he finally hit it with, you know, it's okay if you're gay. I totally understand, you know, that's great if you're gay. I'm not gay. And he's like, yeah, you kind of are. And that, of course, set the guy off. And he does that with the next guy as well.
Right. Yeah, so, you know, he storms out, and, you know, he says to Jerry, you know, I'm tired of doing this pro bono. I'm not doing this anymore.
Yeah, and I'm not seeing him again.
Now we are on to the next one. And he's being hypnotized.
Yeah. Which I thought was strange that Jerry was in the room with him. That Jerry and
yes.
the TA were in the
room. Yeah, that was creepy.
Creepy because you're going to hypnotize a guy. You don't know what he's going to say or what he's going to feel. And here you are sitting in the room and you really don't know him.
And why is Tom in there?
Yeah, that just seems so odd to me. But I love how he kind of starts going in. And you think at first, maybe he is being truthful about something that happened to him. And then he goes into the songs, you know, Afternoon Delights.
And then he storms off. Hey, wait, you really hypnotized me, you know? And then what do we do? And so Lambo's like, well, there is someone. And Tom's like, who is he? Used to be my roommate in college.
In desperation, Lambo calls on Dr. Sean McGuire, his college roommate who now teaches psychology at Bunker Hill Community College. Unlike the other therapists, Sean actually challenges Will's defense mechanisms. During the first session, Will insults his deceased wife and Sean threatens him. But after a few unproductive sessions, Will finally begins to open up. Will is particularly struck by Sean's story of how he met his wife, who later died of cancer. By giving up his ticket to the historic Game 6 of the 1975 World Series after falling in love at first sight. Sean's explanation for surrendering his ticket was to see about a girl, but he does not regret his decision. This encourages Will to build a relationship with Skylar, though he lies to her about his past and is reluctant to introduce her to his friends or show her his home. Will also challenges Sean to take an objective look at his own life, while Sean cannot move on from his wife's death. Lambo sets up a number of job interviews for Will, but he scorns them by sending Chucky as his chief negotiator and by turning down a position at the NSA with a scathing critique of the agency's moral position. Skylar asks Will to move to California with her, but he refuses and tells her he is an orphan and that his foster father physically abused him. So this is where we get introduced to Robin's character, Sean. What'd you guys think right off of Sean McGuire?
Well, so he's so totally different. And I was going to get into this a little bit later, but you know, his appearance is muted.
Scruffy.
And he is at a community college, and he is very relaxed looking. Whereas our previous two, you know, the first one, you know, he's in a suit. In our second one, he's in slick black, and so he is starkly different.
And he's smiling.
Yes, that too.
He seems happy, but he's also, you can tell right away if you just want to read a person. His hair is very unkept. He's got the big scraggly beard that looks like he hasn't shaved underneath and things like that.
He's letting himself go a little.
This is a man who isn't moving on with his life. For whatever reason, he's just kind of letting things go. Well, he's not trying to impress anybody.
Well, I think that's a lot to take in
looking
at him in the community college. But I do think that that is kind of presented to us over the course of they decide to go out to dinner together.
Well, this is my read of him after seeing this movie several times, is that, you know, from what we know of his character later, it makes sense now why he looks this way.
Oh, sure. Here's Lambo, and he's introduced to his class. And then we have, I think I have something interesting for you. And so they go out and they have this nice posh dinner, and they come to an agreement about Sean helping Will. And so they meet and they chat.
Well, even before that, during this dinner, this is another just indication, another kind of view that, especially looking at the differences in the life choices that these two have made, that Jerry is very egotistical.
Yes.
Yes.
And Sean,
bragging.
And Sean is sick to death of it. And that's one of the reasons why their friendship hasn't been a close one, is that, you know, Sean feels like Jerry thinks he wasted his life, you know, that Sean wasted his life and wasted his potential. And Sean is sick of Jerry looking down on him.
Yeah, I think that this is a relationship that is based on the past.
Yeah, and really, I mean, we know already Sean was not his first choice. He had gone through other people, and now he's almost desperate. He said there were five. Yeah, and then now he's desperate, and he's going to Sean. And Sean's, you know, one of his first things he brings up is, thanks for the card about, you know, my wife dying. Like,
yeah,
Jerry didn't even show up for it, even though they were college roommates.
And he said he was at a conference or something, yeah. And it's like,
but it was in Europe.
But he also made it seem like it was more important to ask him, why haven't you come to any of the reunions? Like, that was more important than showing up for Sean when Sean's wife died. I mean, it was really odd tension between them.
Mm-hmm.
And
it was politely strained.
Yeah. And you could tell right away, Sean has no interest in helping him whatsoever until he starts hearing about Will and he gets, you know, curious. Maybe Sean hasn't felt challenged in a long time. And now here's a challenge. Here's something he can sink his teeth into.
And so we have Sean and Will. They are introduced to each other. And then Sean instantly, no. Get out.
Yeah. This is, you know, saying something we were thinking earlier is, why the hell are these two in the room? Which he's basically, no, you two have to leave. I'm going to talk to him alone. Mm-hmm. So right away, you know, this guy is going to care about Will and going to care about what's best for Will.
Well, he's certainly taking a different tack than the others.
And I thought was interesting, too, is at first he just wants to get to know him. And so he's just asking probing questions to get to know him. At the same time, Will is doing his defense thing of trying to seek out the button that's going to set Sean off so that he can move on to the next psychiatrist.
And it's the boat painting. The boat painting.
It starts with the boat painting and turns into saying something about his wife. And that's when he realizes, oh, the wife is the sore spot, so I'm going to push it. He even said, don't push it.
Yeah, because when he's there and he mentions his wife, and then that's off limits, Chief, we get a micro smile from Will and a sideways glance, and it's like, this is it. And so he's deliberate in what he's doing next. This is exactly what he's going to do. He's going to push on this.
Yes, but he didn't expect Sean to be so physical, because you could see the surprise on his face. And looking back at what we end up knowing about Will, when he gets grabbed by the throat, to me, it was almost probably taking him back to his foster family or whoever used to beat him. And probably for him, here's someone who's threatening me with physical violence. Here's an older person that shouldn't be doing this.
Mm-hmm. There's some really nice camera work that happens when Will is making his explanation on what he is perceiving the metaphor of Sean in the boat, because Sean is facing us, but he's over Will's shoulder behind him, and Will is in focus and Sean is out of focus. Mm-hmm. And then as the explanation continues, there's kind of a turn that happens in the explanation. And when that turn happens in the explanation, Will goes out of focus. And then we have Sean come into focus. And so I'm thinking that, okay, so this is really starting to impact or make Sean feel uncomfortable about it. But he's reserved enough that he holds it in.
Yeah, he holds it in for most of it. He just, he doesn't fall for it.
Yeah, but it was the wife, you know, that was the 1-2 punch.
Yeah, when he charged at him and grabbed him by the neck, and we got that shot
of just Matt Damon's face with the hand really tight around his throat.
It's a good shot.
That was almost the most powerful shot of the movie. Just the expression, again, the nonverbal cue, the nonverbal expression on Matt Damon's face of fear and surprise.
Well, it's almost someone calling him out on his shit.
Yeah. And so right there, I thought that just painted a picture for us.
And he was very clear. He was very direct in letting Will know, you know, if you ever disrespect my wife again, I will end you. I will fucking end you.
Yeah.
Got that, Chief?
And I like how the session, you know, because Matt responds, or Will responds with, time's up.
Time's up.
And so he walks out and...
And we're thinking that, okay, he screwed this.
Yeah. Well, Jerry even says, sir, are we done? And he's like, bring him back next week or whatever.
4 o'clock.
4 o'clock.
Yeah, he says Thursday, 4 o'clock. Make sure the kid is here.
Is that when we get the bench scene or?
No, we have Sean at home and we see Sean sitting at his little kitchen table, and then we get a shot of the kitchen sink, and the kitchen sink is full of dirty dishes and empty liquor bottles.
Mm-hmm.
And then we go back to Sean again and he's sitting there with a drink that he is looking at, and he is just contemplating clearly what has just transpired between him and Will. And he's thinking long and hard about, you know, I think what's up with his life and what's up with Will and how did he get to him like that? And it's forcing him to think about things that he hasn't thought about in a long time, which mm-hmm. leads us to the next day.
The next day.
Or the next time they get together.
Yeah, the next time that they get together, Sean says, no, we're going for a walk, and takes him out to that park, that Boston park, where they sit down on the bench. And this is almost, for me, my favorite dialogue of the movie.
Oh, come on. This is the Oscar moment.
Yeah, this is the scene where...
This is what got him the Oscar.
Where he really calls out Will on his shit. And he goes, you're brilliant. You can read every book and remember everything. You can understand these mathematics. You can even understand painting. That you can look at a painting and you know everything about it. But you don't have the life experiences. You've never been there. You've never seen it. You've never gone into the Sistine Chapel and smelled what it smells like in the Sistine Chapel. So you may be able to understand the things, but you don't know them.
What'd you think of this scene, Katie?
I liked it a lot. I felt that Will was finally getting someone who was challenging him and he was listening.
Yeah. And you can see,
like, you have a point, you know.
You can kind of see the transition on Matt Damon's face of now he's interested.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, you know, for me, I really thought that, you know, this you're just a kid speech that he just gets done listening to. I thought it looked like that it hit Will hard.
Yeah.
Because he was speechless afterwards.
One point I want to make, and we'll come back to this later, is do you notice how often Sean calls him sport?
Yeah.
He goes, you know, you don't know this sport. You don't know that sport. You know, and he keeps using the word sport. Later on, that changes. And I kind of caught when it changed. And to me, it also represented a change in their relationship.
Yeah.
So we'll come back to that. But I just wanted to point out that, especially during the speech, he keeps referring to him as sport.
Mm-hmm. We do have something else that happens right before, which is we get Will and Skylar, and they're out on their date.
Yes, that's very cute.
Yeah, very cute. And Skylar is so funny.
Yeah, she's delightful.
She's awesome.
Yeah, and she's very playful and honest. And the fact that she's willing to be every bit as goofy as what he's doing, delightful.
That's exactly the kind of women that I dig, that will go into a toy store and just have fun.
Yeah.
And not, you know, don't have to take them out on a fancy dinner to impress them. They just want to be with someone that they enjoy having fun with.
Yeah.
And that makes them laugh. Julie always tells me one of the things that attracted her to me was that I made her laugh all the time.
Yeah.
And she thought that was just the best thing. Mm-hmm. That we didn't need to go out to fancy places or do fancy things. It was just that, you know, I could make her smile.
Yeah.
And then we have them sitting there eating their burgers, and then we have the first kiss. Very sweet.
I loved the whole line about the first kiss where she calls him out of, you're probably thinking about our first kiss. And again, love the dialogue, love the writing of making her a strong character in that she calls him out and says, let's just get the first kiss out of the way right now.
Yeah.
You know, let's do it. And so he's like, okay. And they have their kiss and she makes the pickle comment,
mm-hmm.
which I thought was just really cute. And the fact
it's
that
really
they're all
cute.
Giggly and everything.
So we have Chucky show up the next morning to pick up Will, and
You know, they go to work at that construction site. And then that night, there he is in the pouring rain. And,
oh, I love this part too.
And he's calling her and she's like, hello, hello. And then she
said, I love when she hangs up, freak.
Well, first she calls out the fact that she calls a professor's yeah. name. Is this you again? Creepy. Like somebody's been calling her.
Yes. Creepy. Yes. It was like, ugh.
So gross. So he basically for what, 2 weeks doesn't call her?
Yeah. He won't talk to her.
Yeah. And of course, again.
And Casey calls him out. You went out there all the way and you didn't write down the phone number. Like, what an idiot. And I just love Casey.
But why would Casey say that? You know he memorizes everything.
Yeah. Yeah, that's the other thing I think that is just shows that Casey's just not thinking.
Well, Casey's an idiot.
I love it.
We get
I
that
love
right
it.
Away. But I love it. This is another indication to us that Will ends things before they can hurt him.
Right.
And so he's afraid to pursue anything. And this is where we start to get a lot of talk from Sean about his wife and everything in one of their sessions.
They have the next session that they have is a delightful moment where Will and Sean, they're sitting there in the office and Sean, he pulls out the cigarettes and then Sean says, no smoking. And that's the only thing that is said in that hour session.
I loved the fact when Jerry calls him out and says, what'd you guys talk about? Nothing. We just spent the whole time staring at the clock and
he has to talk first.
And he's like, that's impressive that he could do that. Just sit there the whole time. Well, shouldn't you have said something? No, he has to talk first, which means it's a competition of wills. Who will break first? And if he can get Will to break first, Will might start opening up.
Yeah.
If he starts talking, Will's just going to give him bullshit answers.
Right. We get a real quick snippet with Will back with Lambo, and then there is this completely incensed professor, and Will's like, just read it. Just read it. It just, it's right. It's right. And then you have Tom sucking up afterwards. You're a very brilliant man.
When we finally do get the scene with Will finally talking before Sean, he tells the joke.
Yeah, Sean, he's falling asleep. And then all of a sudden, then he does the joke. He starts talking.
Which is funny because I've heard that joke 1,000 times from different people. And I wonder if I heard it first from Good Will Hunting.
Don't
what
know.
Joke?
The joke about the stewardess.
Oh,
running up.
Oh yeah.
The guy says on the intercom,
it's still on.
I'd love a cup of coffee and a blowjob. And she goes running. And the guy's like, well, don't forget the coffee.
So Will finally starts talking about farts.
That whole thing that Robin said.
Sean
tells the story about his wife who would fart in her sleep.
Yes.
And apparently that whole thing was improvised by Robin Williams. He made it up on the spot.
He's so brilliant. He improvises so much stuff.
Yeah.
In all his work.
I'm guessing it's probably genuine, but I noticed this time when Will is crying his eyes out in laughter that the camera is shaking just a little bit, which means I think that the cameraman was laughing as well because...
Oh, that's funny.
That's exactly the story that I read is that that's Matt funny. Damon's reaction was genuine. He was dying of laughing. And they said, look at the camera shake because the cameraman is also laughing his ass off or trying not to.
Yeah, so, okay.
That's funny. He's so talented. He's so brilliant.
So he tells this story, and this is our indication of Will seems most interested in Sean when he's talking about his love life and talking about his wife.
Yeah.
Because you can see that that's the type of connection that Will has always wanted with somebody.
Yes.
But has never allowed himself to have.
Yeah. And the description that Sean gives to Will about intimacy and how he thinks it should work, you know, is so touching. It's just so tender.
Mm-hmm. And this is where I'm going to bring up foreshadowing. There's 2 points of foreshadowing. Actually, this is more of a callback when Will, basically Sean says to Will, I told my boys that I had to go see about a girl.
Yeah.
And of course, we know that's kind of going to come back with Will and Skylar in some way.
Right.
So during this session, you know, things seem to be flowing well. And then Will says, innocently enough, ever think about getting remarried? And then immediately Sean says, my wife's dead. And then what ends up happening after that is Will ends up giving Sean the advice that Sean just gave him. And how does Sean take it? Time's up.
They're learning a lot from each other.
That was the big thing that I don't know if I really understood in the first times I watched this movie is as much help as Will needs, Sean needs it just as well because he's stuck in his life. And Will really gets him unstuck.
And we get that in the end when, you know, Robin, or when Sean says he's going on a sabbatical, he's going to go travel the world.
It's as if they're two pedals on a bicycle.
Yeah. So really, they become codependent on each other.
Yeah. And this is the second time that we see Will, you know, he cuts Sean deep, you know, emotionally speaking. And yet, you know, Sean, he still comes back to Will.
They have this connection that's turning into a friendship, and they're making a connection again. He's still calling him sport at this point. He's still using, because I tried to note all the times he was calling him sport.
Yeah.
And so he's still calling him sport. So he's still keeping him a little bit at a distance, but they are developing a friendship.
And, you know, it's during this time that, you know, I am realizing that, you know, Sean, he is so not like the other psychiatrists that we were shown earlier. Those other psychiatrists, they're Lambos, you know, the totally stuffy sort of people, you know, like Lambo pretending, you know, he's all that, you know, his little scarves and just good grief. But Sean, you know, he's from the hood. He's from his, Will's neighborhood. And, you know, Sean is flawed and he is modest and very muted in his appearance. And this makes me, you know, realize that at this point, he is going to be our champion that is going to win Will. So Will, he visits Skyler and he's like, mm-hmm. Yeah, I blew it.
This inspired him, I think. The conversation inspired him to go visit
that's
her.
Exactly what, yeah. That's exactly how I took it. You know, yeah, so I was wondering if, you know, let me take you out again.
I'd say you can tell right away, she's got to kind of make him work for it, but she really likes him and is willing to give him another chance.
But she's saying, no, I have to learn this. I have to get this done.
Yeah.
So what does he do? He goes down to a cafe and you see him scribbling away on a cafe. And then he shows up here. I couldn't wait.
So we're going out for coffee now. And she's
it's
like,
so cute.
But I have to understand it. Yeah. But let's go. Your work is done.
Yeah.
And that's, I think, her first indication. I mean, she kind of got it earlier in the bar, but it's her first indication that something's different about this guy.
Yeah, because she looks at it and she's like, where the fuck did you get this?
Yeah, who'd you get this from?
Yeah.
But yeah, it's very sweet.
Yeah. And so, yeah, they ended up going out again.
So it shows them at the dog track. And what I noticed this time around and watching it, they are wearing different outfits because when Will is trying to entice Skyler to go out, he's wearing his sloppy clothes. And then when she and he, and when the two of them are at the dog track, they are wearing different outfits. And it's at the dog track, there's a subtle reference that time is passing because this is not the second date, but it's later, it's past that. And so they've been out on several dates. And then we have a moment that happens here where we have the knowledge that, what? You have 12 brothers? You do not.
Yeah.
Why did he say that?
It's odd.
He's not proud of his life. He thinks.
But that, of all the lies to make up.
But he thinks that if they knew about his story, either they'll feel sorry for him and pity him, or they'll run away because they'll know he has so much emotional baggage. But anyway, what are the brothers' names?
Mucky, Ricky, Denny, Terry, Mikey, Davey, Timmy, Tommy, Joey, Robbie, Johnny, Brian.
Say it again.
Mucky, Ricky, Denny, Terry, Mickey, Davey, Timmy, Tommy, Joey, Robbie, Johnny, Brian.
And so she believes it because he can repeat it the second time.
I love the way she says, say it again.
And so he makes up the story, but you're exactly. I think it's because he's ashamed of his life. He really.
Deflect.
I'm sure anybody he's told in the past about what's happened to him, he gets that look of pity. You ever seen those people who get the look of pity and, oh, woe is you? And
you get
they start
the,
to feel sorry yeah. for him. And so he'd rather just.
I get that from you and Don every week.
Yeah, but you still keep coming
what
back.
What is so sad about your life?
He's got a daughter who won't watch a movie with him.
It is. That's probably one of the worst parts of my life.
It made me get a little teary.
If you put it in the living room, I will watch.
So back. So Will's back with Sean, and Sean says, I read your book last night. Oh, so you're the one.
You're the one.
Oh, that was so funny.
Because he commented earlier, there was a scene earlier when I think Jerry said to him, I think he's read your book. And he was like, how did he find it?
So Will starts asking Sean about how did he meet his wife? And then this is where we get the baseball story.
Oh, and to me, again, this is another whole touching story because I can feel the story. I can understand the story of, you know, they slept at the ticket place to overnight to get these tickets. They went to a bar the next morning, and that's when she walked in and he saw her for the first time and ended up not going to the baseball game because he wanted to spend the day with her. He's like, how could you have skipped that game? He's like, well, first of all, I didn't know he was going to hit that ball like that. And second of all, I didn't want to spend the rest of my life wondering about that girl that got away. And any person that has ever found that one understands that you rather spend time with them than anything else. You know, that's how I feel about Julie. You know, I would rather just go on an adventure with her than go anywhere without her.
Mm-hmm.
And so it really hit something with me, that whole story. And again, Matt, you know, Will's character, or Matt's character, Will, cannot understand that. He can't comprehend that. He hasn't experienced that.
He hasn't allowed himself to.
Yeah.
But, you know, the whole bonding over the sports, you know, guys do that, how guys get so pumped up about sports, you know, because they're both just like, you could tell, you know, as they're talking about that baseball moment.
And they stand up.
Yeah. Guys do that. It's funny that way. And so, yeah. And then that's where we get that classic line. I just slid my ticket across the table. And I said, sorry,
I love the
guys.
Way he told that story. Like, da 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 da. And he was like, wow, wasn't that awesome? He goes, I wasn't there. I love how he like baited that.
I like how, didn't they also work in scenes from the baseball game?
Yeah, there were clips.
They showed clips. So I like how they kind of timed it.
And there were sound effects of the ball hitting. It was good.
And so what do we get right after I got to see?
I see about a girl.
Yeah. What do we get right after that? We have been told that more time has passed because we are at post-intimate moment between Skylar and Will. And she says, why do we always stay here? Because it's nicer than my place.
I love her threat to him and his reaction. Well, if I'm not going to meet your friends, this isn't going to happen again. And what does he say?
He goes, they're probably up right now. Let's call them.
He goes, it's 4 a.m. I'm sure they're up. Let's go now. And I love when they next show him with the friends. They're like, we've been drinking all night and you bring her to meet us now? And he's like, when are you guys not drinking?
Yeah.
But right away, especially with the story she tells, she fits right in with the gang.
Yeah, she's so good.
Because of that captain joke.
Yeah.
She's so good.
The one about the old man wanting the blowjob.
So Sean, he's in a bar and he's telling Will's airline captain joke to a bartender. Yes. This is where Lambo shows up and then they end up, you know, getting into kind of an argument about what they think is best for Will.
And I love how they both make their points. Lambo basically talks about how everybody knows who Albert Einstein is. Everybody knows who Isaac Newton is. Everybody knows who this person is.
Who's Gerald Lambo?
I have no idea.
Which is him.
Yeah. And so he's basically showing this. This is why he's basically saying this is why Will has to do something with his life so he can be up there with these greats. You know, he's got the intelligence. He's got the smarts. So he needs to do this. He needs to be this person. And I love how Sean reacts to that. Do you know who Ted Kaczynski is? And Jerry doesn't know who Ted Kaczynski is, this brilliant guy who did all these things. And of course, the bartender's like, yeah, the Unabomber.
And so he says, well, you know, the boy is in a meeting right now that I set up with him over at McNeil. And we cut,
Holden McNeil.
And so we cut to the interview. And lo and behold,
there's the negotiator. And I love how he's just stringing together what he thinks is smart words. And he gets like almost $200 out of them.
Oh, yeah.
No, they only had 78 bucks. He asked for 200.
Yeah, he asked.
They only had 70.
Yeah, you're suspect. I'm going to be watching you.
So we cut to Will and Skylar, and they're at a cafe. And Will, he's kind of impatient. You want some help? No. She's curious to know, why is it so easy for Will? And he comes back with a piano analogy.
Yeah, he basically talks about, you know who Mozart is? And she's like, well, I don't know much about him. And she goes, well, you know Beethoven. And he goes, well, they could just look at a piano and know how to make it play and know how to understand music. They could just read it. He goes, it's the same with me. I look at books and I look at mathematical equations and they just make sense to me. She kind of gets that, but she tries to explain to him that, yes, you can do my work for me, but I need to do this. I need to understand it, and I'm not like you. And so I think this is the first time I feel like Will has gotten a taste for understanding that not everybody wants the quick path. Not everybody wants that kind of help, that he needs to let other people get to where he's at.
Now it's a little bit later in the evening, and they're cuddling, and she asks him to come to California with her.
Yeah, this part kind of broke my heart when he basically says no, because he likes his life here. He likes his friends. Sean brings up a point a little bit after this, and it makes perfect sense. Will seeks out relationships that won't betray him, that won't break his heart. Basically, people who are loyal to him. And that's his friend group. They are loyal to him. As Sean puts it, they will take a bat to anybody's head for Will. And he's got that here. He's got the friend group that won't betray him. He's got, you know, various jobs he can do that he can leave whenever he wants. Everything is comfortable for him and everything is safe here. So this is his reason why he tells her, I can't go to California with you. I've got my life here.
He gets upset and he's like, you know, I'm afraid that you're going to want to take back. And so then they really get into it.
Yeah. She's like, are your brothers even real?
Yeah. And so, yeah, I just think it was just the fear of failing. He just overwhelms Will.
Yeah.
And she's yelling, you know, I love you. Do you love me?
Yeah. Well, first she asks him about, are your brothers even real? And he responds, what do you want to know? Do you want to know that I'm an orphan who used to get cigarettes put out on me? And, you know, the scar is from when the motherfucker stabbed me and things like that. And you could see it just breaking her heart to hear all this.
Absolutely.
And then she goes into, I love you. And she says a couple times, and she says, if you tell me right now that you don't love me, then we'll just end this and walk away.
And holy shit, what does he do? I don't love you.
That was so gut-wrenching.
Yeah, that's what I said. That's what tore my heart out, because to see her reaction to that. And you know he doesn't mean it.
No.
He's just doing his defense mechanism.
Yep.
He's ending it before she ends it with him.
Katie, what did you think of this scene?
Just hard. I've had my fair share of relationship screaming matches, and it's tough.
Oh. This is when we get to see Matt Damon's pretty cut at this point. Do you notice that
he's cut.
I don't tend to lean that way, but woohoo.
Yummy.
So we see the TA assistant, Tom, and he's chatting with Will before Lambo shows up. And
I love how protective he's of Jerry.
Yes. It's disgusting.
It's almost like saying, if you break his heart, I'll break you.
Yep.
It almost gave me Burns and Smithers vibe.
A little bit,
little.
I could see that. I can totally see that.
And so this is where we get Lambo and Will, and they are sparring with each other. And then Will, he kind of sort of goes off on Lambo.
Sean kind of warned him exactly this was going to start to happen. The more he pushes Will to have a life that he doesn't want, Will is going to push back on him and put up his defensive walls and everything. And this is where their relationship really starts to change, of Will not wanting to be around Jerry anymore, not wanting to work with him anymore. Is this where he burns the paper? And
oh, yeah.
It destroys Jerry that immediately he looks at it and goes, this can't be right. This can't be right. And he's like, Will kept saying this. It's right. Trust me. Go home. Read it. It's right.
I'm sorry that you can't understand it.
Yeah. And then he goes and he burns it. And Jerry just loses his mind. It was almost like Skyler's reaction to Will saying, I don't love you. To now here is Will burning a bridge with Jerry, almost in the same regard of, I don't love math as like you do. It was almost like the same kind of breakup, in my opinion. Will breaks up with Skylar and later storms out on Lambeau, dismissing the mathematical research he's been doing. Sean points out to Will that he is so adept at anticipating future failure in his interpersonal relationships that he deliberately sabotages them to avoid emotional pain. Chucky likewise challenges Will over his resistance to take any positions he interviews for, telling him he owes it to his friends to make the most of opportunities that they will never have, even if it means leaving one day. He then tells Will the best part of his day is that brief moment when he waits at his doorstep, thinking Will has moved on to something greater. Will walks in on a heated argument between Sean and Lambeau over Will's potential. Jerry leaves and Sean and Will talk, and it comes to light that they were both victims of child abuse. Sean helps him see that he is a victim of his own inner demons and accept that it's not his fault, causing him to break down in tears in Sean's arms. Will accepts one of the job offers arranged by Lambeau. Having helped Will manage his problems, Sean reconciles with Lambeau, deciding to take a sabbatical. Will's friends give him a used car for his 21st birthday so that he can commute to work. Later, Chucky goes to Will's to pick him up, only to find that he's not there, much to his happiness, as Will had finally done what Chucky had been wishing for all these years. Will leaves a note for Sean asking him to tell Lambeau that he had to go see about a girl, revealing he passed on the job offer and instead is heading to California to reunite with Skylar. Roll credits.
So we have Will, and he's in this job interview for the National Security Agency. He asks, so why do you think I should work for the National Security Agency? He starts explaining theoretically that, you know, I'd be breaking code. And, you know, it starts out as an NSA interview, but then it ends in Sean's office, right, as his explanation goes on. So
I like how it kind of morphs into that.
Yes, it's done very well. And as he's explaining it, there's this very slow pull of the camera in on Will. And then eventually the camera backs away from him.
With this whole story and this conversation he's having where he's recounting what happened at the NSA, he actually explains that, you know, me solving this one code is going to lead to a whole village dying down the road.
Right.
And me getting in trouble with my family and blah, blah, blah. And you're absolutely right. You know, Sean calls him out on it, that he sees too far in the future and he predicts disappointment and tragedy down the road so that he never goes down that road.
Right. And Sean comes out and he asks him, you know, do you have a soulmate? Mm-hmm. And then this is where, you know, Sean really presses him, you know, what do you really want to do?
Just really shows his negative outlook on almost everything. And it didn't seem that way at first watching the movie. But now that we've uncovered all these peels of this very intricate onion, he's facing a lot of inner demons.
Yeah. And so, you know, I feel like Sean really, you know, cuts to the core here. You know, what do you really want to do?
Which is a good question, because you as the viewer are kind of asking the same thing.
So since he won't answer his question, he tells Will to leave, and Will, he gets angry, and then, you know, he comes right back at him. Look at me. What do you want to do? And Will just won't answer the question. So we cut to Will, and he calls Skylar, and she says, I love you. And he cuts into her, and he just says, see you around.
So rude.
Yeah, it's awful. And so we have a little montage of Skylar. She's leaving, and Will choosing not to be with her. And then we see Lambeau, and he's calling Sean, and he's like, the boy's in here. This is bad.
And doesn't he kind of, it almost felt like he made a threat that he was going to send him back to jail.
Well, that's what it's exactly about, because Jerry, he has to record that a session took place. And if a session doesn't take place every week, that's it. He's gone. He's out.
Until the parole's over.
There was something that was really briefly mentioned, and they did it in passing so that you wouldn't really notice it right away. Because I kept thinking about this. How does a guy who's on parole eventually leave for California? He couldn't leave the state. But they made a quick little mention that when he turns 21, it's all done, and he's a free man. And so That's why the birthday scene later on was so important, because they reveal he's now turned 21.
Right. So, you know, and so where is Sean if he's not in session? He's at work at that construction site. And so, with him being at the construction site, clearly he and Sean, they're on the outs right now.
Yeah. But this is also where we get our best example of foreshadowing in this movie. And it's painfully obvious, which is, this is where we get Chucky telling him the best part of his day.
Yeah, they start talking, and then, you know, they talk a little bit about Skylar and then job prospects, and we get that great speech from Chucky.
Because Will says, why do I need to work anywhere else? I'll just do this for a living. And you could see all of a sudden Chucky getting pissed. He says, I'll kill you if you keep working. If you're in 20 years, if you're still here, I'll kill you. I'm serious. I will kill you.
Yeah, I love that speech, you know, about Will doing something better than this. And then, you know, when he starts, you know, with the, look, you're my best friend, so don't take this the wrong way. And then that's where we get that wonderful speech.
Yeah, and it makes perfect sense. It's a little bit, it's almost like a middle point between Sean and Jerry, in that he's basically saying, we don't have potential, the workers here. This is what we can do, and we'll be content doing this the rest of our lives. You, on the other hand, can do so much more. You're so much smarter than
us. Swing for the fences, man.
And if you are still here with us doing this, you're going to break our hearts. You're going to kill us. We're going to end up being so pissed off at you, because you could have basically gone out and lived our dreams. You could have been, you know, you have so much you can do. And so he basically says the best part of my day is thinking that,
those 10 seconds.
Yeah. And I love the fact that he says the 10 seconds of, you know, me showing up at your door and you not being there. No note, no mention, no nothing. You've just gone. You know, right there, he's telling us this is how the movie has to end.
Mm-hmm. I love how this is such like thoughtful display of love mm-hmm. in Will's life that has been consistent. The friend is there for him. That's why they're so loyal to each other. And him saying, even if you're not here and we can't hang out every day, he wants that for him.
Yeah. And they give us that story. And then I think that's kind of what sets everything in motion for this third act with what's going on in Will's head.
Right.
Is he starts realizing, maybe I should go after her. Maybe I should do something more with my life.
He needs a push.
And I think part of it too is it's almost like Chucky giving him permission. You know, he thinks that, you know, my friends are loyal to me. I need to be loyal to them. And at this point, Chucky's saying, you don't owe us anything. In fact, if you want to owe us something, you owe us to go do something better.
So whether it's the job or it's California.
Or Skylar. He's like, you know, that kind of gives the impression of, what the fuck did you do with Skylar? She was perfect for you.
So now we have Jerry and Sean, and they're vociferously arguing over Will in Sean's office, and they're arguing over Will's loyalty. They're just pushing back and forth really hard. And, you know, it's great here because it shows how impassioned these two grown men are about Will.
Again, it feels like two fathers trying to decide the life of their son. And they're each, you know, saying that they are the father and I'm the father and this is what's best for him. And I love the camera shot of first we kind of see a silhouette walking towards the door.
Yes.
And it's just a dark silhouette. Yeah. And then as he gets closer, you can start to make out some of the details. And you know it's Sean listening at the door.
Exactly. And that is, it's really juicy stuff for Will to hear, you know, that these two guys that are arguing over him. When Will opens the door, you know, it's right at the crescendo of the argument. And he's like, I can come back. No, come in. I was just leaving.
This is where I've been kind of talking about using the term sport a lot and showing, to me, that was a defining piece of the relationship between Sean and Will. This is where I believe it might be happening a little bit before this, but this is, if you go back and watch the movie, you'll notice this is where Sean starts calling him son instead of sport.
Yes.
And this is also where you kind of see that I think Will starts to look at Sean like the father he never had and that the father he always wished he had. And that's why when Sean is now saying son, that is what's really starting to knock some of these walls down.
And it's at this moment, that's where Sean, he's holding the file. You want to see the file?
Yeah, he's like, you got the file? He goes, yeah, you want to look at it? And they open up and there's some horrific pictures in there. And Sean tells him that, you know, I had an abusive father who used to kick the shit out of, you know, my family. And I would always antagonize him so that he would beat up me and not my brother or my mother. And then Will opens up and says, well, my father would come home and put three things on the table, a belt, wrench, and something else.
Yeah.
I can't remember what the third thing was. And he's like, oh, well, you know, Sean says, well, I would choose the belt because that would be the least amount of damage. And he goes, I chose a wrench. Why would you choose the wrench? Fuck him.
Yeah. And so here they are comparing, you know, their abuse stories with each other. They have a shared, a kindred past, if you will, in a very sad way.
We get a scene here that I feel is lampooned in so many different things. Family Guy has done it. I think The Simpsons have done it. It's been in a bunch of different movies, and that's the scene where it's not your fault.
So this is where Sean, he finds out you broke up with Skylar. Want to talk about it?
No.
You want to talk about it?
No.
Hey, Will, I don't know a lot. You see this? All this shit? It's not your fault.
I know that.
Yeah, it's not your fault.
I know.
How many times does he say it's not your fault?
I think it was, well, the whole amount, I think it was 6 times.
10 times. And then once he starts opening it up, you know, and he lets go.
Yeah. And again, this was probably one of Matt Damon's best scenes of acting because you could see he goes from the snarky Will Hunting to starting to kind of look emotionally disturbed to then tears start forming in his eyes and that tear comes down his face and he just, the walls shatter.
Yeah. He starts ugly crying.
Ugly crying. And it's finally the first time anyone's ever given him permission to say, it's not my fault. that all this crap happened to me. I didn't start it. I didn't cause it. This was just bad people, and that there are people out there who care about me.
Katie, did you tear up at all?
Yeah, that scene's hard to watch.
Of the scenes in this movie, I thought that would be the one, but it wasn't that scene that got me to tear up. It was a different scene that got me to tear up, and we'll get to that one in just a second. That was just that, you know, the emotional breakthrough. Maybe it's because I had seen this movie so many times. That one didn't affect me as much because I knew it was coming, but still, very powerful scene.
We cut to Will riding on an empty train, and he's clearly contemplating what he's had just happen to him. And then we see him at home, and he's contemplating there as well. And then we see Will, and he's downtown, and he's down there for a job position. And okay, I guess he's going to take a government job.
I think the first time I saw this movie, my first thought was, okay, well, he's going to take this job, and then is he going to try to commute? Because I knew he had to get back in touch with Skylar, but was he somehow going to see if the job could transfer there? Or I got really confused. Why is he taking this job? Because I knew he had to go reconnect with Skylar.
Well, apparently to make it more dramatic.
Yeah. It's basically the red herring, whatever, the thing they throw us to send us down the wrong path of where we thought this movie was going to go.
So now we have Will and Sean, and they're discussing his job situation. And then it ends with, time's up. So that's it. We're done. Yeah, that's it. You're done. You're a free man. I just want you to know, Sean, you're welcome, Will. He doesn't even get it out. And he has, you're welcome, Will.
And then I believe we go to him and Chucky just talking.
Well, they're down at the watering hole, and it's his 21st birthday.
And they take him outside and reveal they have put together a really shitty car for him.
It's so cute.
Yeah, they give him the ugliest fucking car he's ever seen in his life.
Yeah. And when they open up and show that engine, oh my God, that was crazy.
Now we cut to, so Sean, he's packing up his office and Jerry shows up. And Jerry, he's like, so Sean, he's like, me too, Jerry.
Yeah, they seem to do that. And then I think that's a guy thing that we don't have to get all the emotional baggage out. We can just say, you know, we have an argument, we have a fight. You okay? I'm okay. We're good.
Yep. Mm-hmm. And so let's head out. And so they head out and they have a drink. And so they are reconciled.
And I love how we get the revelation that Sean is now going to travel the world. Obviously, the impact of Will has also changed him as well.
Right. He's willing to come out of his shell.
Yeah, he's willing to come out of his shell. When they're at the restaurant and they're talking, it's revealed that before, Sean had said, I'm not going to those reunions. And now Sean is asking, are you going to the next reunion?
Yeah, that's right.
I thought that was kind of an interesting twist that now he was interested in the reunions and interested in getting on with his life.
This movie started out with so many people, with so many walls up, so many grouchy outer faces, and ended with everything unraveling and being smoothed over. And it was very satisfying.
I almost feel, too, like Jerry, they don't really say it that he's gone through anything, but they kind of slightly hint at that having this experience with Will has opened up his mind to, I got to let people do their own thing.
And let stuff go.
Yeah. And to realize his life hasn't been as bad as he thinks it's been.
Yeah.
You know, he didn't waste his potential because he did what he wanted to do.
So we cut to Sean and he's packing up at home. We see Will pull up.
In his shitmobile.
And he sees Sean up in the window. And then we cut also quickly to Chucky, Morgan, and Billy. They're in the car. We're back to Will and we see him put the letter in the mailbox. Then we're back to the gang. And this is where they pull up to Will's place. He honks the horn. So we keep cutting back and forth. These two story points are wrapping up. Sean, he finds Will's note. And then Chucky, he's calling for Will now through the window. And, you know, he does that 10-second walk up to the door, and there it is.
And to me, when I mentioned earlier that I didn't tear up to the it's not your fault, I don't know why, but especially this time, he looks through the door and then looks through the window.
And then you see it hit him.
And he starts to kind of smile a little bit, like, oh my God, it's finally happening. That's when it hit me. That kind of choked me up a little bit. And this was, I thought, Ben Affleck's best role in the scene, because the nonverbal stuff. But it was the best that he expressed on his face at the same time, while a little bit of smiling, a little bit of sadness that his friend has left. It's going through his head of everything now his friend is going to do. Yeah. And that he's finally living up to his potential
and almost like he's going to be able to live vicariously through his friend. Mm-hmm. Everything he's ever wanted, the best for his friend, especially going after the girl. I'm sure that's the first thing he hit is he's going after Skylar. And the fact that we gave him the car, that he's going to go to California and find her, he's now really helped his friend.
Yeah, I love how he smiles a couple of times up there on the porch.
It's that crooked smile of Ben Affleck.
Yes.
Yeah, and so he smiles one more time as he starts to turn away. The car horn honks a couple of times, and then the music swells a little bit with the strings, and then it turns into a flute. And then as Chucky accepts that Will is truly gone, he turns and he walks back to the car smiling.
Yeah, and as he gets in the car, what does Casey do?
Go to the front seat!
Well, he goes, as Chucky's walking back to the car, you know, he just says he's not there. But yes, that's a wonderful moment, because immediately Morgan, he gets out of the car and he cranks himself around to get the shotgun.
Love him so much.
So now we see Sean and he's reading Will's letter, but the letter is read in Will's voice. Sean, if the professor calls about that job, just tell him, sorry, I had to go see about a girl.
One of the things I love so much about this movie is the last line. And I just found out that last line was ad-libbed by Robin as well. Do you remember what that line was?
Son of a bitch. You stole my line.
So good.
I thought that was a perfect way to end
the movie. Cherry on top.
Because there's no dialogue after that. No. We just see
him driving.
Will driving in the car and heading towards the sun, I believe.
Well, and then that's the last shot we got. The car is on the road.
I like how they left that a little open-ended.
No. Absolutely.
I don't need to know what happened.
Yeah.
I don't care what happened.
I don't want to know.
Because it really wasn't about what happens to him after, or Skylar,
it's the
or anything.
Journey.
It's the fact that he finally made a change in his life, and he's not going to live in the books. He's going to live his life outside of the books. He's going to go and have a life.
This movie always makes me feel good, you know, because it shows you that everyone's got shit going on and you are still worthy.
Hey, Ken, are you ready to rate this movie?
Yeah, I'm ready to rate this movie. Katie, are you ready to rate this movie?
I'm so ready to rate this movie. John, are you ready to rate this movie?
I don't need a therapy session to know that this review I'm about to give is not my fault. It's not my fault.
Yes, it is.
Well, you're probably right. Hey, Ken, how do we do our ratings?
We do our ratings on a scale of 1 to 5 fucks. 5 fucks is a movie that we think is cinematic gold. A 1 fuck movie is a movie where you get done watching it, and I'm never watching that again.
And what's a zero?
A 0 fuck movie is where you get done watching it, you turn to your buddy and you say, oh, for shit's sake, what the hell? Why would you make me? I want 2 hours and 6 minutes of my life back.
In other words, we don't give a fuck. Katie, since you picked this movie, would you like to go first or would you like to go last?
I'll go first. I think this movie is 4.5 out of 5.
Why 4.5 fucks?
I'm thinking of 5 means I would watch it every single day until the day I die. I wouldn't want to watch this, but I think it's made well. It has good actors, and I would recommend it to everyone I know.
Okay.
Right on.
Ken, do you want to go next or you want me to go next?
No, I'll go. Good Will Hunting is a wonderful movie. It's been a couple of years since I've seen it, but I got to say that it is a rich watch every single time. Although it's dialogue heavy, that's for sure. The writing is delightful to have these different characters being developed the way that they do. The friend circle. Delightful. I love the friend circle. These guys are so great together with all their smack talking back and forth with each other. I thought that this is probably Robin Williams' best role. He is fantastic in this. The performance that we get out of Matt Damon and Ben Affleck, I think, is fantastic as well. These characters are so richly written. The character that Minnie Driver plays, Skylar, I think that she is such an interesting person. And every time that she is on the screen, I love listening to her take on things. She is a wonderful person to put up against Will. And I think that they make a wonderful couple together that I always think about will be somewhere in that future after Will gets out to California. How can they not be together? Because they were so good together when we were watching them for this story. I think that Lambo, he is wonderfully pretentious. The little scarf that he always wears so annoying. It makes him
look too long.
It just looks so silly. But I get why it's there because, you know, that's a part of who he is, right? This is how it's conveyed to us that he is, you know, hoity-toity, if you will. And he's sort of smug on himself. I didn't necessarily think that the movie was too long, but it starts to feel a little bit like that. I really like it when we get to the third act. The third act is where it's at. And, you know, when I think about favorite scenes for the movie, and I'll ask us again after I'm done with my part, I just want to say that this is comfortably a 4.75 fuck movie.
4.75 fucks from the professor. Good Will Hunting is a heavy dialogue movie that hits you in the feelings. I know the first time I watched it, I didn't really appreciate it. There definitely are some great scenes, and it's very quotable, but the pacing was difficult, and it felt like some of the scenes were just thrown in there to add time. But as I've had a few more relatable life experiences, the emotional side of Good Will Hunting hits me harder, and I definitely appreciate this movie more nowadays than I did back then. Matt Damon is fantastic playing Will Hunting. He does a great job conveying a walled-off, damaged character. Affleck, he's good in his role, but it feels like something is missing in my opinion. His best scene is the last scene where he knocks on Will's door and doesn't even have any dialogue. He does a great job with that non-verbal part. Minnie Driver as Skylar, well, I felt like she was the perfect pick for this movie. She's adorable and imperfect. And it reminded me of something that when Julie and I got married, we kind of worked in to basically say that one of the reasons we're so great is we're both imperfect, but we're perfect for each other. Robin Williams, of course he was amazing. Every scene he was in, he stole the show. Even his nonverbal parts, his emotions were clear from just the look on his face. He just knows how to elicit emotions from the viewers. Rest in peace, Robin. We miss you. As for the others, maybe I'd say Stellan stands out a bit, but none of the rest really knocked my socks off. And Casey Affleck's Morgan just felt like he was put in the movie to annoy the audience. But then again, growing up, didn't we all have a friend just like that? This is definitely a movie that everyone needs to see at least once. And if you're a fan of Robin Williams and you haven't seen this movie, shame on you. It's for those reasons I'm giving Good Will Hunting 4.5 fucks. So, with 4.5 fucks from me and 4.75 fucks from the professor, that gives us an average of 4.6 fucks.
Right on.
That ties it with Stand By Me, Rocky, Ocean's 11, A Quiet Place. It makes it a little bit better than John Wick Chapter 3 Parabellum, Snatch, The Princess Bride, Shaun of the Dead, and it puts it just under Black Panther, Pulp Fiction, and Goodfellas.
It's in good company where it should be.
Yeah. I feel like it's about a 4.5, 4.6 movie, so that works out perfectly for this movie.
So did you have a favorite scene, or do you have a favorite scene, Katie, John? When you think of Good Will Hunting?
The one where Sean is saying it doesn't matter if you're perfect or not. Yeah, that's my favorite.
For me, I think the first time I saw it, it was the How Do You Like Them Apples, and when he challenged whoever that jerk was, his name, Clark.
Yeah.
When he kind of challenged him and put him in his place. Going forward now, I want to say it was almost every time that we had Will with Skylar. I really enjoyed their chemistry together.
Yeah, well, it was real.
Yeah, in fact, I believe Matt Damon ended up dating Minnie Driver after this movie.
They were together. If I remember correctly, by the Oscars, they were apart.
Mm.
And so it was sort of an awkward thing. Yeah, there you are. And it's just like, ugh. So
what was your favorite?
You know, the first place I always go to, how about them apples? But I think that, you know, I really enjoy It's Not Your Fault.
Mm-hmm.
And I definitely had some tears several times over this movie. The sessions that Will and Sean share with each other are very rich, and I enjoyed all of those as well.
All right, that is going to wrap it up for this episode of Three Guys in a Flick. If you'd like to know which movie we are reviewing next, please check the website. And speaking of which, hey, Ken, where can they find us?
That's a good question, John. Where can they find us?
Katie, where can they find us?
3guysinaflick.com, 3guysinaflick on Instagram.
They can find us, of course, as you mentioned, on our website. They can find us on all of social media, and they can find us at any place that hosts a podcast. And in fact, while you're listening to our podcast right now, make sure to go ahead and like our podcast. Go ahead and subscribe to it. If you can, leave us a comment. We would love to hear from you. You can also go to our website and you could submit a movie you would like us to review next. I want to go ahead and thank Katie for being our guest this week. Did you have a good time?
Yes.
Thanks for coming on, Punkin.
Yes.
Thanks for having me.
I also want to thank anyone who listens and has suggested a movie. If you keep listening, we'll keep recording. For Three Guys and a Flick, I'm John.
I'm Ken.
And I'm Katie. How do you like them apples?
Three guys with some mics, yeah, dive into the flicks. We're here for the real talk, no time for the tricks. Starn as the captain, steering us right. Kid drops now to shed light. John with the comics, bringing the hype. From the good, the bad, to the absurd, we break it down, make sure you heard. Passion for the screen, we ride or die about movies. You know, we always give a fuck, no lie.
Are we boring you?
Yes. Katie, what do you think of this scene?
What scene?
Okay.
Katie, when's the last time you watched this movie?
We started it last night around 8 p.m.
Mm-hmm.
And I did not finish it.
You did not finish
it? No, I didn't.
Ooh.
I was hanging out with a boy and then I was like, I'm bored. Let's pause it. And then we never got back to it. And
but you've seen this movie before?
I've seen it a bazillion times. I know it front and back.
But you chose a boy over doing your homework.
Yes.
Okay, but you're supposed to spin the line, I had to see about a boy. Oh, come on.
I'm not that cool. But let's pretend I am. Whoa, this is crazy. How do people do this for their job? I've always been like, oh my gosh, I could just have a podcast and just talk. And it would be so easy. But like now you're like, you're in your own head, you know? This is so weird. It's just weird that you can hear your own voice and it's not in your brain. I forget that we're like recording and this can be edited. Poop fart diarrhea.
But you know, I keep everything for the stingers.
Oh no.
And now comes the professor's favorite time. Hit me. You got a good porn name?
No.
Katie, of course, you've got one.
Okay. Goodwill Grunting.
Ooh, I really like that. Goodwill Grunting.
That's a contender.
I had Good Willy Hunting and Gooey Will Hunting.
So you said Goodwill.
Goodwill Grunting.
Grunting. I think that's the winner this week.
Goodwill Humping.
Ooh, that's a better one. That's a good one.
All right. May all of your days and nights be filled with happiness. All right. Fuck off. Good night. Three guys in a flight, keep the passion alive.